I'll start by, maybe I should start by saying just a little bit. For those of you, is there anyone here who doesn't really know at all what Sacred Harp is? Helen, okay. Singing from this oblong songbook, first published in Hamilton, Georgia in 1844. It is four-part a cappella song, a cappella almost always, and sung best that way, but very strong four-part harmony with each of the four parts, bass, tenor, alto, and treble, having more melody to them than you would typically find in your congregational hymn book. It's therefore more interesting to sing, and it is, to those of us who do it regularly, just incredibly appealing. Okay, from an early chapter here. To start with, a couple of decades ago, I walked into a music equipment store in a suburb of Birmingham, shook hands with the young manager, and handed him a Sacred Harp tape. We had previously talked by phone about his interest in Sacred Harp, and I had brought the recording for him to hear. He popped the cassette, already cued to the song Stratfield, into his player and brought the sound up agreeably loud and reverberant throughout the store. The two of us stood there luxuriating in the bright, powerful music, truly a thing unto itself. Just before the fa sol la's had given over to the words of the song, the front door opened and a young man walked in, headed back in our general direction, and then paused almost mid-step with a quizzical look on his face. "Is it people?" he asked. The question, hanging naked there, seemingly free of context or opinion, tickled me then and amuses me still today. I, of course, gave the chap an affirmative yes or nod, and apparently satisfied, he went on about his business. I used that brief exchange as pointer toward a larger question about Sacred Harp, about the source of its unique appeal for me and for so many others. How, against all odds, has this singing tradition, so fragrant of the rural South of the mid-19th century, not only survived, but now well into the 21st, greatly expanded its reach? Sacred Harp, I could have told the young man, is not only people, and people only. It is today, as it was from the start, the people singing. Can you hear me okay? Is it too loud, or is it? Thank you. As much as anything else, that seems to me the essence of its power and charm, its magic, its durability. There's something stirring about the sound and the idea of a crowd of people singing, a veritable hillside of voices. Not a congregation shadowing the church organ's preponderances, not the trained choir's thinner, more rarefied sound, but the bold, lusty sound of strong, unaccompanied community singing. And at its height, in fact, people looking and sounding as if they were singing for their lives, which in a way, of course, they are. Writers, observers practically fall over themselves, attempting to describe the splendors, the rawness, the peculiar, transcendent, sonic power of Sacred Harp. The New York Times, quote, "Unique sound, dense and almost eerily spiritual. Gregorian chant meets bluegrass." Rolling Stone, "The soaring magnificence of Southern Sacred Harp choirs, a robust, harmonically intricate blend of country joy and unearthly drone." A Minneapolis periodical, The Old Times, quote, "A ferocious, full-volume nasal snarl with something of New England about it and something of the South. Vowels narrow and intense, every consonant hammered home, it was the noise of a whole people busy being born." And then there's the line attributed to both H.L. Mencken and folklorist Alan Lomax about the singing sounding like a cross between a steam calliope and a Ukrainian peasant chorus. And I wrote that back before the word Ukrainian would sting the way it maybe does today. Though we may find it reminiscent of Gregorian chant, or bagpipes, or gospel singing without accompaniment, or the stadium singing of European football clubs, but with harmony, Sacred Harp has, finally, for observers across the spectrum, a sound like, well, like no other. Years ago, I asked one of my sons to sit for a moment and listen to a recording of a Sacred Harp song he had once singled out for a compliment. Sound familiar? I asked. Dad, he replied, they all sound familiar. Betty, that was Will. Betty, Della, and somebody. I knew, of course, what he meant, pejorative or not, and knew that in the way he put it, he had the target plainly in view. I think, too, of a story a woman once told me about a child in her family who had found himself beyond weary with the fa sol la chords swelling all around them in a little country church that day. They'd been singing the same song all morning, he protested. The distinctive sound of Sacred Harp, this sound of the people singing, that song, that sound, when I was about 20, called me out of my ordinary life and pointed me down a path of rich associations I could hardly have imagined. This book is a re-exploration of that path.